Welcome to you from Chem Help ASAP. This video provides practice problems that allow students to determine the major product of a reaction and classify the reaction as SN2, SN1, E2, or E1. The problems in this video are a bit more challenging and best suited for students who are at the end of their first semester of organic chemistry. All these problems have been pulled from the chemical literature. Citations are on the slides. Check the video description to find links to printable copies of these problems and their solutions. There will be links during the video that will connect you to other videos that provide more detail on these types of reactions. Okay, I always start these videos with a very quick review of the main ideas of the topic. We're trying to predict products and assign a reaction type. SN2, SN1, E2, or E1. To review this task, let's fill in this table and see how different leaving groups, methyl, primary, secondary, and tertiary, behave in these reactions. How do I approach these problems? The first thing I look for is a reactive species, often an anion, that can act as a nucleophile or a base. I first look for a nucleophile. The classics are the really good nucleophiles, azide and cyanide and the thiolates. If you have one of these good nucleophiles, then you will normally observe an SN2 reaction with any substitution on the leaving group except tertiary. Tertiary is too hindered for an SN2. The really good nucleophiles are normally not reactive enough to force any reaction on a tertiary leaving group, so you get a no reaction. Many nucleophiles are anions that also show considerable basicity. These include alkoxides, hydroxide, and the amines. These behave much like the good nucleophiles, except as the leaving group becomes more hindered, as in secondary or tertiary, you tend to see an E2 reaction instead of an SN2. Now, sometimes you don't have a strong nucleophile or base. If you have a weak nucleophile, often water or an alcohol, you are dependent on loss of the leaving group to form a carbocation as a strong electrophile. The carbocation is then attacked by the weak nucleophile to give an SN1 reaction. In this case, tertiary carbocations are best for the SN1. Secondary carbocations are borderline. Primary and methyl leaving groups almost never form a carbocation. What if you don't have a nucleophile or base, weak or strong? This is likely an E1 if you can form the carbocation. If you can't, there will be no reaction. Heat can also sometimes be seen to help form the carbocation. The guidelines I've mentioned on this slide are general tips. Exceptions abound, but these guidelines generally hold true. It's fairly common that you do not have a leaving group, and the first step of the transformation involves making a leaving group. These reactions almost always start with an alcohol. Alcohols are readily converted to a halide. You'll also often see other leaving groups, the sulfonates, the most common of which is the tosylate, OTS. You might also encounter mesylate or triflate. All of these, whether a halide or sulfonate, are good leaving groups for the SN2, SN1, E2, and E1. Finally, another way to make an alcohol into a leaving group is through protonation with an acid. That's really common, and we'll see this approach in a couple of our problems in this video. Okay, let's see some problems. First problem, we have a primary halide. Over the arrow is an amine, Amines are both nucleophilic and basic. Since we have a primary leaving group, if you go back to the table on the first slide, you'll see that this reaction should favor an SN2 reaction. The amine will act as a nucleophile and will kick out the bromide. This reaction includes some base, which will remove the extra hydrogen from the amine after the substitution has occurred. Here is the final product to the right. We have made this new CN bond, and this reaction is an SN2. Problem two. Here we start with an alcohol. There is no good leaving group. All we have over the arrow is strong acid. Perfect. We can protonate the alcohol to make a leaving group. Notice that we don't have a nucleophile or base present, so the tertiary leaving group can leave and form a carbocation intermediate. Without a nucleophile present, we will lose a beta hydrogen and form an alkene. So here are our potential beta hydrogens. We will lose one of these and form an elimination product. Here is our elimination product, and here is the alkene, and this is an E1 reaction. One common issue I see with students is that they sometimes want a strong base to remove the beta hydrogen. This is a deprotonation after all. So they invoke a really strong base, like sodium hydroxide, to do the reaction. However, this reaction is run in strong acid. There is no NaOH in the reaction. That's okay. Beta hydrogens to carbocations are very acidic. Even very weak bases can remove them. For example, in this reaction, we just formed water. Maybe water does the deprotonation. When I need a weak base under very acidic conditions, I'll often use B with a lone pair. I'm not committing to a specific base, but I'm just saying that something will do the deprotonation. When in doubt, make sure you follow the style that your instructor prefers. Next question. This is a more difficult question. Here is another alcohol that's not a leaving group. The first step involves MSCl, mesyl chloride, that reacts with alcohols to form a mesylate, one of our sulfonate leaving groups. So OH becomes OMS. Great. The next step adds this molecule. This is a bit tricky. We have a base in this reaction, the cesium carbonate, and the base is just strong enough to deprotonate the OH group. Let's show the conjugate base. Now, if without some experience in chemistry, I admit it would be easy to expect the nitrogen to act as a nucleophile instead of the oxygen. But once we've settled on the oxygen as the reactive atom, we need to decide if the oxygen will act as a nucleophile for an SN2 or base for E2. This is a secondary leaving group, our mesylate. So expecting an E2 would be reasonable. In this case, however, in part because of the pi system of the neighboring ring and something called the phenacyl effect, this secondary leaving group will do an SN2. Remember that we will get inversion of stereochemistry during the reaction. Here is our product. Note the change in stereochemistry. A clue for favoring the SN2 over the E2 is that if a chemist wants to do an E2 reaction, you'd normally use a simple base, like KOH or sodium methoxide, rather than this more exotic molecule. The last comment, we do have an iodine. Why isn't the iodine a leaving group? We will normally only consider a group to be a leaving group for the SN2, SN1, E2, or E1 if the leaving group is attached to an sp3 carbon. The iodine is on an sp2 hybridized carbon, so it's not a suitable leaving group for these reactions. Here is the next problem. Now we have an iodine on an sp3 hybridized carbon. This is our leaving group. It is secondary. The reagent over the arrow is DBU. I don't teach about DBU in my organic class, but DBU is a strong nitrogen base. I won't go into details, but if you Google DBU base, you'll get all the information you could want. So we have a secondary halide, strong base. This will be an E2 reaction. Our only beta hydrogens are over here. So we'll use our base to remove a beta hydrogen and install our alkene to get the E2 product. There is our product with the alkene. Our molecule does have this silicon group. This is a siloether. As you get into more advanced chemistry, this kind of thing is pretty common. It's difficult to pull reactions from the chemical literature and completely avoid reagents and functional groups that are not often encountered during intro organic chemistry. Here's another problem. Again, we start with an alcohol, so we need to make a leaving group. In this case, we have a strong acid, HBr. We can protonate the alcohol to form the leaving group. It's a primary leaving group. We're not given a separate nucleophile, but the conjugate base of this acid is bromide, which is a decent, not great, nucleophile. For this primary leaving group, bromide can attack, do an SN2, and generate our final product. Here is our product, and this is an SN2 reaction. Here is yet another reaction that begins with an alcohol. Alcohols are indeed very common in these SN2, SN1, E2, E1 reactions. We do have a strong acid, so the alcohol will be protonated to make a leaving group. This will be a secondary leaving group. Okay, what else is in the reaction? We have an alcohol over the arrow. This is a weak nucleophile. These conditions match an SN1 reaction. Weak nucleophiles do not perform SN2 reactions, just SN1. The leaving group will leave to make a carbocation. Let's try to quickly draw this key carbocation intermediate. The carbocation will be attacked by the alcohol over the arrow. Here is the product from this reaction, and it's shown following deprotonation of the hydrogen on the nucleophilic alcohol oxygen. We did go through a secondary carbocation, which is not great, but this carbocation has resonance from both of the neighboring aromatic rings. A fair question is, why doesn't the acid protonate the alcohol over the arrow? That likely does happen reversibly, but the alcohol over the arrow is primary and cannot form as stable of a carbocation. Therefore, this is an SN1 reaction on the alcohol for the starting material on the left. Problem 7. The first thing that catches my eye in this problem is the azide. Azides make me think SN2 reactions. But in this question, we're not adding an azide. It's already in the molecule. Okay, well, what else do we have? We have an alcohol. Normally, we convert the alcohol into a leaving group through a protonation, conversion to a halide, or formation of a sulfonate. Our reagents do not, however, indicate that kind of reaction. In this reaction, we are given a base. Sodium hydride. Okay, I guess we're not making this alcohol into a leaving group. The only reasonably acidic hydrogen for our sodium hydride base is on the alcohol. We will deprotonate it to form an alkoxide. What we have done is convert the alcohol into a nucleophile, an alkoxide. In the next step, we have a primary halide. This is allyl bromide, which is a fantastic SN2 electrophile. So our nucleophile will attack the carbon bearing the leaving group, and here is our product formed through an SN2 reaction. Note that we made a new CO bond. This product is an ether. And this overall transformation of an alcohol to an ether is called a Williamson ether synthesis. Last problem. Not surprisingly, we again have an alcohol. It's hard to find it in the middle of this larger structure. Over the arrow, we have an acid. We will protonate this alcohol with the acid to make a leaving group. We don't have any additional reagents, no nucleophiles, so we can only go forward if we can make a carbocation. And we can do that since this is a tertiary alcohol and will form a fairly stable tertiary carbocation. Instead of redrawing the structure, I'll just mark out the alcohol and put in a positive charge. When you make a carbocation in the absence of a nucleophile, you get an E1 reaction. We need to lose a beta hydrogen. We have two different ones to choose from. These two above the carbocation and another to the lower right. Normally, we would choose the more substituted hydrogen because it will give the more highly substituted alkene, the Saitsev product, which is typically the more stable product. This particular reaction actually gives the less substituted alkene as the final product, the Hoffman product. Why does this reaction break the rule? There is likely some energetic issue with the Saitsev product that would be hard to predict unless you had experience with these specific types of molecules. Regardless, this is an E1 reaction and forms an alkene product. I hope you have found this video helpful as a quick look at many different SN2, SN1, E2, and E1 reactions. Please subscribe, like, or make a comment. Thank you for watching. Remember that links to these problem sets are in the description.